Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session on the Scottish Fiscal Framework Independent Report and Review. We are joined today by David Phillips, Associate Director at the Institute for Fiscal Studies and one of the authors of the Independent Report, and Professor Mary Spowage, Director of the Fraser Avalder Institute. I'd like to welcome you both to the meeting. Good morning. So we're going to have around an hour for this session, but before we move to questions, I'll just set the scene a wee bit. The November 2021, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, Kate Forbes, MSP, confirmed that the independent report will focus on block grant adjustments only. However, in return, the Chief Secretary of the Treasury agreed that this will inform a review that will be wider in scope to ensure that the current arrangements are thoroughly assessed and options for reform considered, and the input is obtained from a wide range of stakeholders as part of the overall process. But on the 2nd of August 2023, the Deputy First Minister confirmed that, and I quote, "I've now reached agreement with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury on a package of changes to the Scottish Government's fiscal framework." The Deputy First Minister explained that she had judged it appropriate to concede to a narrower scope for the review than the more fundamental review originally envisaged, again, and I quote, "in the interest of securing long-sought practical borrowing and reserve flexibilities and protect those arrangements that we already have in place, which work in our favour." So I just wanted to set that scene for the questions that follow. So one of the things, David, that was secured by the Deputy First Minister was an indexed per capita mechanism for calculating block grant adjustments, which will be adopted on a permanent basis. So if you can just tell us what the benefits of that are to Scotland. And also, I noticed that it says further on the paper that this will be reviewed every 50 years. So I'm just wondering if that's what they mean by permanent, or if you have another view of what permanent might mean in this situation.
Okay, thank you. Yes. So the index per capita method of adjusting the block grant takes account of two factors which might mean that Scottish revenues don't keep pace in cash terms with those in the rest of the UK. The first is that it takes account of the fact that Scotland's got initially lower tax capacity than the rest of the UK. So I think at the point of devolution, for example, income tax revenues per capita were about 79% of those in the rest of the UK. By using a percentage change in tax revenues to calculate the block adjustment, that accounts for that because the percentage is based on the Scottish revenues. The other element is the per capita element, and what that does is it accounts for the fact that there is differential population growth potentially between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So how this method works is it takes the block grant adjustment from the year before and then applies the percentage change in revenues per capita in the rest of the UK and then the percentage change in Scotland's population. So that insulates Scotland from both having a different initial level of revenues per capita and if its population change is different. And what we've seen in recent years is that Scotland's population change has tended to be lower than in the rest of the UK. Scotland's population has been going up less quickly. And hence, by accounting for that, it means the block grant adjustment grows less quickly than if it had to keep pace with the sort of overall level of growth in the rest of the UK. So this means that over time, we think that compared to the alternative method, what's called a comparable model, it reduces the increase in the block grant adjustment by about £50 million a year on average. So that means each year Scotland benefits £50 million, then £100 million, then £150 million, then £200 million, compared to if the comparable method had been used. Now, I think it is worth pointing out that this method probably is the one that best addresses what's called the no detriment principle, the idea that Scotland shouldn't, in expectation, lose out from tax devolution just because it's been devolved, although it can lose out if the economy performs less well, or it can benefit if the economy performs better, and of course can benefit or lose from its policy changes. That method that's been chosen, IPC, probably best out of the ones on the table, addresses that. But it less well addressed some of the other principles in the Smith Commission, and that was a kind of key part of the report, that there is this fundamental tension between, for example, the taxpayer fairness principle, which says that revenue shouldn't be redistributed from the rest of the UK to Scotland post-devolution, and then the no detriment principle, which says Scotland shouldn't, in expectation, lose out. Those two principles are fundamentally in sort of conflict. The agreement prioritises the no detriment principle, and that it benefits Scotland financially compared to the alternative.
And Mary's, basically the Deputy First Minister more or less said, well, the reason we didn't actually go down the road that we said we would in November 2021 was because the UK government were basically saying, well, it's a kind of take it or leave it model. Is that what you understand the situation was, that this was the only room for manoeuvre the Scottish government had in terms of accepting this?
Well, I suppose it depends what the alternatives were on the table. I know the committee in the past has had concerns not just about the population risk that the Scottish budget's open to, in terms of the overall population, as David's explained, but also the mix of our population, the extent to which it's ageing more quickly, or the extent to which our population's made up of people of working age and that sort of thing. But those different options didn't seem to be on the table. It was since the fiscal framework's been in place since 2016, both of these methods have been calculated, the comparable method and the index per capita method. And it did seem likely that the question about the block grant adjustment in the review would be which one of these is going to be chosen. And obviously the Deputy First Minister was also looking for further flexibilities, which they did get as part of the agreement. You know, it wasn't just the choice of the Scottish Government's preferred BGA option out of these two. But there was also the further flexibilities on things like borrowing, which have been made more flexible. So it looks like the Deputy First Minister therefore made the calculation that it was better to have this agreement confirmed after many years of it sort of dragging on, and to take these additional flexibilities that were also being offered, perhaps, and to some extent, given the choices that are facing them immediately for this budget round. You know, the fact that there is more flexibility in borrowing, for example, does help this current year when there's a large reconciliation to be made.
David?
Yes, if I can kind of follow on there, I would very much agree with what Mary was saying. I think there's a couple of further points I'd make. Firstly, in our independent report, we did look at some of the alternative options, like adjustments related to demographics. And I think there's kind of two points there. Firstly, it's not clear, at least in the short to medium term, that adjusting for demographics would necessarily benefit Scotland. While Scotland's population is ageing more rapidly, a lot of the difference is not then on the working age population, it's on the child population growth. And actually, I've seen some calculations suggest that if you adjusted for the demographic mix, in the short term, Scotland could actually lose out because pensioners do pay tax, whereas very few children pay tax. So it's not clear that Scotland necessarily would, in the short term, benefit from adjusting for the age mix. Well, that might change in the longer term. I think also the second point I'd make is that, again, some tensions in the sort of principles come to the kind of fore here. Firstly, if you adjust for differential demographic mix, you might think that if the Scottish Government has limited control over these long-term demographic trends, well, controlling for that is consistent with the no detriment principle because it stops Scotland either gaining or losing from things it has little control over. But if you think that these things are, to some extent, affected by Scottish Government policy, for example, the ability to attract workers or businesses to Scotland, well, perhaps it's less than consistent with what's called the economic responsibility principle, that Scotland should bear the costs or the benefits of its fiscal policy. And I think it's reasonable for governments, when they make a decision, to sort of trade off these different objectives and also trade off the objective of simplicity, if you like. The more you add these additional bits to the fiscal framework, the more complicated it gets. And we've also seen with the census just how big the kind of, not just changes in the overall population, but even more so the changes in the age distribution and demographics can be. And that would then add another bit of volatility potentially on a sort of 10-year cycle when you have the census updated. So I think whilst there could be arguments made to control for these additional factors like, say, demographics or tax-based structure or other things, they're definitely trade-offs with respect to complexity and with the other principles of the fiscal framework. The last thing I'd say as well is that in terms of the sort of breadth of the agreement, I think there was quite a strong difference in opinion on what the fiscal framework itself actually consists of. I think perhaps the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament's view was this consists of the sort of not just the technical arrangements around borrowing and block adjustments, but the wider fiscal settlement, what's devolved, I think the Treasury just took a very firm line that that's a separate issue. That's an issue of the settlement, not the framework. And I think the Scottish Government made a decision that in order to make progress on the framework, those issues could be put to the side and perhaps handled in a more political manner.
Yeah, and I mean, it wasn't a negotiation between equals. Obviously, the Treasury also had to work hand through these. So I suppose the Deputy First Minister, as well, will certainly put to her, no doubt, had to accept more or less what progress had been made. And some of that progress was in terms of capital borrowing. So they'll no longer be fixed at £3 billion in total and £450 million a year for capital expenditure. I mean, these will now increase in line with inflation. And, of course, Mary, you've pointed out the fact that that should have really been the case from the beginning, because the value of that borrowing, those borrowing powers have been eroding significantly over time. But what I found interesting in terms of how the capital borrowing power and inflationary impact has been assessed, it's based on the GDP deflator. And between 23-24 and 27-28, that's predicted to be 5.5% in total, not this year, but over the next 4 years. I mean, is that in any way realistic? So what that would mean is that the resource borrowing limit would go from £600 million the current financial year to £633 million, in capital borrowing limit from £450 to £475, etc. So how realistic is that, Mary?
Well, you know, the calculations we did were based on that will be our predictions at the time. So as we've seen, issues around the inflation and the wider economy haven't evolved quite as lots of people have expected, and certainly inflation hasn't come down as quickly as we expected. But, you know, on that sort of stock of borrowing, the increases will be linked to inflation now, as I think they always should have been. These limits were obviously set in 2016 in a low inflationary environment, but I think everybody could have looked ahead to think that these should be index linked because the power of them will erode over time. But, you know, in the quantum of borrowing, it's not going to make a massive difference to the borrowing power of the Scottish Government. They will, in theory, have the same purchasing power in years ahead, but they will remain basically tied into the sorts of limits they have at the moment. And we need to remember, I think, that the Scottish Government over the last few years has used up a great deal of that borrowing limit, which may well constrain future administrations in terms of the amount of borrowing that's able to be.
And in your submission, Mary, you've said there's still a question, though, about whether limits for forecast error are adequate, given the risks the Scottish Government is facing, and given that forecast error is all that this borrowing mechanism could be used for, it seems sensible to consider that it should be extended further. You know, and that's talking about,
the predicted reconciliation for this current year for income tax was £712 million prior to the outturn data coming in. Now, self-assessment receipts surprised on the upside, and that ended up just below £400 million instead. So it hasn't breached the limit just for income tax, this is. But it could very well have done, and the modelling that's been done in the past by the Fiscal Commission suggests that that limit could be breached perhaps once or twice a decade, the £600 million limit, this is. So, and that's for income tax alone. This borrowing power for forecast errors to be used for all taxes and of all social security as well. So I think there is a question to the extent to which this is still sufficient to manage the risk that's there. Now, one could argue that obviously there are chances that there'll be positive reconciliations in the future, and taxes and will surprise on the upside, so social security may surprise on the downside, and therefore there's less that needs to be spent than there was budgeted for, and the Scottish Government has the facility to sort of save up and put money into the reserve and so on to even out some of these things, as well as using borrowing powers. But I do think there's an argument, given that this borrowing is only for forecast error, and that the Scottish Government may be managing a large reconciliation essentially with 6 months' notice for a budget year that's coming. I do think there's an argument for the limit to be increased further, so that it will actually cover an income tax reconciliation that may come fairly regularly.
OK, David.
Yeah, I would echo the points there. I think one can make a case that because it's the powers are constrained for use simply for forecast error, they cannot be used for other circumstances, that you could have a potentially even unlimited capacity to borrow for those forecast errors. I think that's conditional upon the forecasting being done independently, which it is obviously with the SFC. I'd be much more worried about that if it was done by the Scottish Government. I think the other thing one could do if one was concerned about the potential to effectively defer the issues indefinitely would be to say, well, actually, borrowing needs to be repaid within a certain time period. So one could combine increases in the borrowing limit with perhaps a restriction on the time period over which those borrowings had to be repaid. Yes, and I was going to say, the other thing I think that's maybe perhaps not appreciated, actually, in the short term, with the devolution of social security benefits and the difficulty in predicting for things like disability benefits, just what share people will actually qualify, what rate they'll qualify for, how long they'll stay on. I actually think there's quite a lot of uncertainty on the social security side at the moment, even though these are not quite so demand-led benefits as, say, unemployment benefits, which should go up and down with the cycle. At the point of introduction, there is quite a little bit of uncertainty around these benefits. So that might be something that's worth looking at in the kind of data as it starts to come through. Are there big forecast errors for social security benefits?
Mary?
Yeah, I'd absolutely echo that. And, you know, it's been so obvious with income tax because obviously we've had a few years of this now and we've had these large reconciliations predicted and then in some cases emerging in practice. But I think, yeah, social security benefits is really important to keep an eye on to what extent we're seeing forecast errors in those. The Scottish Fiscal Commission, you know, do their best to forecast the demand which these benefits will see. But obviously the Scottish Social Security Agency is wanting to take a different approach. The Fiscal Commission says that's likely to lead to things like higher take-up and all of these sorts of things. So there is quite a lot of uncertainty, I think, over how much we might end up spending on some of these benefits. As David says, they're not as demand-led as ones that are tied to the economic cycle. But these are new benefits with you know, new criteria delivered by a new agency, relatively new. So keeping an eye on the extent to which these are generating forecast errors that would need to be covered by this facility is an important thing as well.
Okay, and I mean, you've said in the independent report, David, that relevant data used to forecast the block grant adjustments and to determine tax and welfare receipts should also be reviewed to ensure it's sufficiently robust and comprehensive for those purposes. And you make a number of other recommendations, one of which, for example, is whether the OBR and SFC forecasts could be better tied to minimise this risk.
Yes, so I think one of the issues you have at the moment with the fiscal framework is that you have the forecast for the block grant adjustment being made by the OBR. That makes sense because the OBR is the forecaster for the tax revenues and social security in the rest of the UK. On the other hand, the forecasts for Scotland for revenues and for spending are by the SFC. To some extent, that makes sense because that is the official forecaster for Scotland. They can take account of more factors that are Scotland-specific. But as well as Scotland-specific factors driving differences between those two forecasts, they can also just be differences in their judgments about the overall performance of the economy. And my understanding is that currently, when it comes to the earnings forecasts, it's not the case that the SFC thinks that earnings will grow more quickly or much more quickly in Scotland than in the rest of the UK, apart from maybe a little bit related to the financial services industry. It's just that the sort of underlying model or sort of framework the SFC uses on earnings projections and forecasts just differs a bit from the OBRs. So whilst the OBR's earnings in its current forecast going down below 2% over a few years, the SFC took the view that's just unlikely to happen given sort of where wage settlements are and sort of, you know, sort of benchmarks that kind of guide wage settlements. So what that means at the moment is that part of the forecast increase in Scotland's tax revenues relative to those in the rest of the UK, to some extent, is driven by differences in judgments about the overall performance of the UK economy, including Scotland, rather than expectations about how Scotland will under or overperform compared to the rest of the UK. And it's only really the latter part that matters for the actual final ultimate budget impacts for Scotland. So what might happen is either the OBR revises up its forecast to match the Scottish SFC, in which case the block grant adjustment's higher, brings down the budget, or the SFC has to bring down its forecast to match the OBR and the revenues. So I think that is one of the challenges that you have with a sort of a system of having two separate forecasters forecasting separate sides of the equation. Now, solving that, I don't think is super easy, because you don't want these guys to just agree on everything, because you want to have some, if you like, you want to avoid groupthink. You want to have some challenge. You don't want people to just be copying each other. But I think the extent to which there can be discussions and sort of clarity around what the factors are that are driving these things. So to what extent is it differences about, you know, Scotland's earnings versus UK's versus just overall sort of optimism or pessimism? Firstly, the forecasting body should have a good understanding of that so they can kind of really think about what they're doing. Secondly, I think it needs to be communicated to Parliament, to the Scottish Government, so that when looking at the sort of, particularly the medium-term financial strategy and the spending review, there's an understanding of what side the risks are in that. Because I think as it stands, perhaps the risks are weighted more to the downside in terms of like lower funding than on the upside, given part of the growth in tax revenues is this difference in overall optimism rather than difference in Scotland-specific optimism.
Yes, Mary.
For me, you know, I'd absolutely agree with that. And I guess we shouldn't mix up the spring experience with the autumn one. You know, there is a much bigger gap in the spring. Now that things have settled down a bit and you know, hopefully there's a sort of a year-round budgeting process which we can rely on about when things are going to be. But obviously the spring budget was in early March, and then the 31st of May was when the SFC presented their forecast. And I think in the evidence that they gave to this committee, what I would take from that is that you know, not that they know what the OBR is going to do, but they expect that probably that the next OBR forecast will significantly revise up their earnings forecast. That's what I took from the evidence that they gave, without them actually saying that. So, you know, I think that they think that they're in a better place at the end of May, and that's probably what they would expect the OBR to do. And we have a much smaller gap between the forecasts now at the end of November and in December for the Scottish budget, which are the ones that matter, obviously, for setting the budget. We've seen issues when the gap has been longer in terms of the 2020-2021 experience, which has generated the reconciliation that we've got to deal with in the 2024-25 budget. So when the gaps are smaller, there's less likely to be these big divergences in judgment, which are just caused by how the economic conditions have changed, which I really think that's what this part of the story between the March and the May earnings outlook. But it is always possible that they will have differences of opinion on overall economic performance and the overall earnings forecast, which is what really matters, obviously, for income tax. So that is absolutely possible. So as David says, I think that that's good in some ways to avoid groupthink, and everybody, you know, forecasters should have a healthy debate and not always agree on things, and they may well have different opinions. They have different roles. The SFC are there to forecast the Scottish revenues and Scottish economy to the best of their ability, and to not take into account how that interacts with the OBR's forecasts of the UK and the BGAs. They do a lot to help scrutiny of these things, but their role is to get their forecasts as right as they can for Scotland. And, you know, so these things will always be in tension.
David?
Yeah. If I may come in very quickly, I was going to say, I think what Mari says there is correct in terms of it's not the role of the SFC to, if you like, predict the other side of the equation, but what the Scottish Government's role is, perhaps, is to take both sets of forecasts and the potential issues around uncertainties and the balance of risk, is it on the upside or the downside, take that into account when it's making its budget decisions about to what extent to try to build up reserves or draw down reserves. That's one of the things the Scottish Government can do to take account of those potentially unbalanced risks.
Okay, thanks. Just lastly for me, before opening out to colleagues, fines, forfeitures and fixed penalties. I understand at the moment that that's approximately £30 million, but will be £25 million, a flat deduction from the block grant going forwards. Is that linked to inflation at all, and are those figures accurate? We almost seem to have two sets of figures, £30 million this year and £25 million from now on, which seems to be a bit of a reduction.
That is a block grant adjustment that's taken off the Scottish Government's funding, and Scotland then gets to keep the revenues collected from those.
Yeah,
so by
yeah.
reducing the block adjustment, that means that Scotland gets more than it otherwise would have if they'd kept it at £30 million. Mm-hmm. And by freezing that in cash terms, which I believe the agreement is, any inflationary increases in those, Scotland gets to keep in full. So I think that the Scottish Government would be relatively pleased with that part of the deal.
Yeah. Sorry, as long as we don't become a more law-abiding society. Okay, thanks very much. John, to be followed by Michael.
Okay, thanks, convener. The second of the bullet points in relation to the Smith Commission, well, it's the second on my list anyway, but it talks about the devolved Scottish budget should benefit in full from policy decisions by the Scottish Government, etc. So is the assumption there that if Scotland varies from the rest of the UK, that is entirely Scotland's responsibility and it is under our control, for better or for worse?
Shall I come in?
Yes, that'll be fine.
Am I on?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So, yes. So that is the principle that I think is termed the economic responsibility principle. And I think the way to interpret that is that for taxes or for spending that is devolved to the Scottish Government, if Scottish policies, whether related to those specific taxes or spending items, or more generally, for example, policies that might boost the economy or policies that might harm the economy, that Scotland should bear as far as possible the full benefits and the full costs of those changes. Now, it's quite hard to do that in practice because, for example, let's say that one of the impacts of a Scottish policy is to attract more high-skilled workers from the rest of the UK into Scotland. Now, as it stands at the moment under the block adjustment mechanism, Scotland would get to keep the higher revenues generated in Scotland. Because some of the people are coming from the rest of the UK, that actually would reduce revenues in the rest of the UK and slow down the increase in the block grant adjustment slightly. And Scotland would actually gain a little bit more from those extra revenues, because it would be gaining both from its higher revenues itself and a little bit from the impact on the rest of the UK. You can see other instances where those effects might work in opposite directions.
Okay, that's helpful. Can I just say where I'm trying to go with this, which is the impact of London? Because, as I understand it, London is an outlier, certainly in the UK and possibly in Europe. And broadly speaking, in most things, Scotland competes quite well with the rest of England, Wales, Northern Ireland, the rest of the UK, apart from London and the South East. But if London, which I think it's tended to do, grows faster than the UK average in the economy and tax and all the rest of it, then we have no control over that, but we are being punished for it.
So on that, I think I would distinguish between the two sides of the fiscal framework, if you like. So I think one of the arguments that can be made for saying, well, look, when we look at the block grant adjustment, we shouldn't look at kind of trends in revenues in the rest of the UK as a whole. We should exclude London, because by adding London in, you're making the comparator not fair for Scotland, because whilst revenues in Scotland might keep pace with the rest of the UK, excluding London, if the rich in London are pulling away from the rest of the UK and from Scotland, well, Scotland can't keep up with that. Conversely, actually, if in a downturn there's a huge fall in the top incomes in London and it's dragging down revenues, actually Scotland isn't seeing that, so why should Scotland, if you like, be benefiting from this kind of fall in top incomes in London? I think you can make that case. I think the other side of the equation, though, is that the way the spending side of the budget works is that the as that tax only in London is spent, either it is spent on things that are subject to the Barnett formula, and hence Scotland gets its share of that revenue via the Barnett formula, or it's spent on things that are UK-wide, whether that is social security or debt interest, which on average Scotland, if you like, receives a population share of that spending as well. So I think if you look at just the revenue side, I think you can sort of make a case that, well, look, yes, Scotland is is potentially being compared to a baseline, it's hard to keep up with. But if you also kind of reflect on the spending side of the budget, that money does come through to Scotland, if you like, through the Barnett formula or through spending on UK-wide things. And I think that's, again, it comes back to this sort of tension between no detriment from the tax devolution and then the taxpayer fairness about redistribution of tax revenues from the rest of the UK. And again, I think it's, you know, it's where you draw the line on those things. The further you draw towards no detriment, the further you move away from taxpayer fairness, and you need to draw the line somewhere.
Mary, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, just to absolutely agree with everything David said. You can't divorce it from the way that Scotland's funded through the Barnett formula. And, you know, if you look at spending on services in Scotland compared to other parts of the UK, and particularly parts of England, Scotland does have higher spending. And, you know, so the fact that revenues generated in London and the South East will be funding spending either in devolved areas in England, which generate consequentials, or UK-wide spending is an important thing to bear in mind when we're thinking about the budget overall.
But as you said, Scotland has above-average spending, but the Barnett formula is designed to reduce that gap, as I understand it. And on top of that, the fiscal framework, given that London, in, certainly in recent years, seems to have been doing better than the rest, you know, that seems still to me, despite what you've said, to be again disadvantaging Scotland. I mean, I take it the point if London economy collapses, that would benefit us. But that doesn't seem to be the evidence so far.
Just quickly, and then I'll let if David wants to talk about Barnett convergence, he can do so. The Barnett formula convergence hasn't really happened to the extent to which it was expected for various reasons, including the differences in population movements over the years, and also the impacts of things like spending cuts during the austerity years and things like that. So it hasn't really happened to the extent that was expected. And you know, we do still have significantly higher spending in Scotland than in every part of England. And I think we should bear that in mind.
I think I would add that, you know, I agree with Mary that the Barnett squeeze hasn't really happened to date. There was, I think, three factors that have been kind of holding it up. One is population, two is the cuts in the 2010s, three was actually Scotland benefited from an error in the way that business rates were accounted for in the Barnett formula in the 2010s, about £1 billion by 2015. But that is going to change. We already have seen it start to squeeze down since about 2020. In 2019, it was about 129% of the average for England per capita in Scotland for devolved services. It's now about 125%. I'd expect it by the close of this decade to be about 122 and falling below 120% by the mid-2030s. That squeeze will put pressure on the Scottish Government's budget in the years ahead. I think you're also right that if it's the case that London and the South East sort of pull away from the rest of the UK in the long run, and one thought that it was not within the capabilities of the Scottish Government to make policy changes with the levers available to it to change that, that there could be a potential for divergence and a fallback on the income tax side. But I'd come back to this point that, given where the Smith Commission said that there are these two principles, on the one hand, Scotland shouldn't lose out from tax devolution in expectation, effectively. On the other hand, post-devolution revenues in the rest of the UK should not be allocated to Scotland from devolved taxes. Those are just incompatible. Either one needs to go back to those principles and revise that, or choose one to prioritise. In this agreement, the Scottish Government and the UK Government have, I think, chosen to largely prioritise no detriment over taxpayer fairness, but not completely, and hence there is still some potential for detriment around issues, for example, like if the South East and London pulls away from the rest of the UK and Scotland.
Mm-hmm. So you are saying that, having been at 129%, rightly or wrongly, we are on a decline to 120%.
Yeah, and probably in the longer term, given current population sort of projections, I'd expect it to sort of converge about 115%. Now, given Scotland's demographics, given Scotland's socioeconomics, that probably is still a little bit higher than Scotland's relative needs, but it means that many of the things that Scotland has traditionally benefited from and enjoyed, such as, you know, free tuition, free personal care for the elderly, other things like that, those will have to be funded via alternative means going forwards. The sort of the more universal social welfare state in Scotland will be more difficult to fund in 2030, 2040. Even if the UK government was to match spending needs in the rest of the UK, which is a big if, even if, it would still be hard for Scotland to fund that going forward than it has been traditionally in the past, given the Barnett squeeze.
But there hasn't been any assessment of needs for quite a long time, I think. And, I mean, if needs includes rural areas, you know, we've got big challenges in that. I think Mary wanted to come in.
David might correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the last big assessment of this was done in the Holtham Commission for Wales many years ago. When was that? 2010? That did suggest that Scotland had been relatively overfunded by the Barnett formula by quite a way, and that Wales had been generally underfunded. And I think that's the last big assessment of this that's been done, but I think it would certainly be interesting to update that. That did take account of things like the higher cost of living services in rural areas and all of that sort of thing. But it did still suggest that Scotland was considerably overfunded compared to need, if you were using a needs-based formula. So I think there would be really interesting to redo that exercise and to see where we are now, given all of the changes that have happened to, you know, the health and wealth and the outcomes of lots of different people across the whole of the UK.
I think it would be particularly interesting to look at it given the rise in the elderly population and particularly the concentration of elderly people in more rural areas, because if you have, you know, the older population is one where a large share of spending goes, and if they are in the more rural areas where it's harder to deliver services, I think they have become increasingly more so in rural areas, that could change some of the figures a little bit compared to, say, 2010 when the calculations were last done. That's true.
Okay. And I think David Phillips, it wasn't you. I was going to quote somebody else. So the Deputy First Minister told us at a previous meeting that both governments were having to make compromises. Do you see the UK has made any compromises in this?
I think the UK has made compromises. I mean, my overall impression is that both governments will be reasonably happy with the agreement because they avoided the big risks they wanted to avoid. So the UK government's compromise was on the block grant index, block grant adjustment indexation, where partly because of individuals involved in the negotiations, there was a particular focus on trying to make sure Scotland's block grant adjustment mechanism treated population the same way as the Barnett formula does. So that's what's called the comparable model. That was brought in Wales in the fiscal framework there. I think the UK government compromised on that. It would have wanted to put that in there, because several people feel it's very unfair that Scotland is effectively protected from slower population growth on the revenue side, but benefits it from it on the Barnett formula side, that there's this asymmetry in there. So the Scottish Government, UK Government compromised, I think, on that one. Although, as I said, I think you could argue that by compromising, it made it more consistent with the no detriment principle, which is one of the principles of the Smith Commission. I think the other area where both governments compromised, actually, was on the Crown Estates. The UK government wanted to index, I think, the Crown Estates to revenues in the rest of the UK, largely to account for the fact that with these offshore wind farm licences, if it had been fixed in cash terms at its old level, well, Scotland would have got its offshore wind licences as revenues and then would have got a Barnett share or another share of the revenues being spent from the English and Welsh licences. Treasury thought that was unfair. They wanted to index it. Scottish Government argued, well, our position is different because our Crown Estates actually is quite different to what you've got in the rest of the UK. We haven't got part of Regent Street and sort of central London estates that are racing away in value. You can't index it to that. In the end, they compromised £40 million by 2028, which I think is roughly halfway between full indexation and fixing it in cash terms. So I think there was some compromise there. I think where the Scottish government would have felt that it compromised was perhaps on the, whilst it got an improvement in its borrowing powers, that rather mean indexed to the amount of revenues or spending at risk, which typically goes faster than inflation, it was linked to inflation. So I think there was a compromise there. But I think overall, the Scottish government will be pleased it's kept the index per capita and it's got some increases. The UK government will be pleased that it had some increase for the Crown Estates and that it didn't have to grant very substantially increased borrowing powers. So I think both sides, the impression I got is both sides are pretty happy. And the Scottish Government, I think, won an award for its negotiations at the SIPFA event. So I think both sides are fairly happy with what they've done.
Did you want to come in, Mary Spurge? And could you also maybe comment while you're at it, where are we now with Scotland-specific shocks?
Sure. I agree. I think both of them be happy. And I think, to be honest, generally the teams of officials, I imagine the politicians involved will just be happy that it's done. I mean, I think, as the convener touched on, obviously there's a question of kind of, well, what now in terms of this agreement and any review of it in the future? And I think, obviously, you will, I'm sure, be interested as a committee in to what extent there'll be any scrutiny of future discussions or agreements on this, given there was very limited... there was obviously a consultation that went out, but in terms of any sort of discussion or consultation around the agreement, there obviously wasn't any, and it came out during recess and caught everyone by surprise. So the sort of scrutiny and the involvement of Parliament, I suppose, in this is a wider question. In terms of the Scotland-specific economic shock, the provision that was put into the original agreement was that borrowing powers would be doubled for forecast error in the, from 300 to 600 million in the event of a Scotland-specific economic shock, which was defined as Scotland's economic performance seriously underperforming that of the UK and also being very low as well. That provision has been removed. And the borrowing limit was just increased to 600 million all the time. So there is no current provision for additional flexibility or borrowing powers in the event of a downturn in Scotland that's specifically sort of, just in Scotland rather than a downturn across the UK. So there's no provision there for further borrowing in the event that happens now.
And I mean, if there was a specific shock, I mean, like, say, tourism, food and drink are all particularly Scottish sectors, would that cause us a problem?
Well, to the extent which one impacts on the income tax revenue take, for example, if hours were to be constrained or wages were to be constrained in the event of a Scottish-specific economic issue, the extent to which... perhaps there is increased social security payments, although, as we said earlier, the social security payments that are devolved aren't generally linked to the economic cycle as such, but it could have an impact potentially, and potentially other spending in areas through crisis funds or other things that local government manages and these sorts of things. So, it could mean if there was a Scotland-specific economic issue, as we did see in 2015-16 when there was a downturn in the oil and gas industry, it's likely that there'll be downward pressure on revenues, upward pressure on spending, and that obviously could cause issues for the Scottish Government. But remember, the additional borrowing flexibilities in the event of a Scotland-specific economic shock were on the forecast error borrowing, so it was additional, borrowing for that purpose, not just to borrow to spend more money on whatever the Scottish Government wanted to spend on the resource side. So, I'm not sure that there was huge flexibility there anyway to deal with those sorts of things, given the restrictions around that borrowing.
Mr. Phillips?
And that's one thing I'd add as well, is that the borrowing powers are not to address downturns in revenues, they're to address unexpected downturns in revenues. And I think that is one thing where there could be a scope to actually further enhance the powers of the Scottish Government to borrow. So at the moment, for example, if in advance it's forecast that Scotland's revenues perform less well than those in the rest of the UK, there is no scope to borrow to smooth that, even if that's just a sort of a temporary dip because of, say, a downturn in the oil and gas industry that's kind of expected to come, or because of, tourism or other factors. I think that there would be issues in giving the Scottish Government discretionary borrowing powers that are very large. I could talk about those if you want. But for a small amount, perhaps, say, 1%, 1.5% of the Scottish Government's resource dell, £400 to £600 million, I think, subject to sort of like some caps on the total amount, some sort of caps on how long the borrowing can be for, I think there's a case to give the Scottish Government some powers to respond, not just to unexpected downturns in revenues or shocks to social security spending, but things that are forecast in advance for social security spending or tax revenues, or unexpected shocks to public service spending, something of like 1 to 1.5% of the fiscal del wouldn't be a threat to sort of, you know, fiscal sustainability, and I don't think would be an issue with regards to fairness to the rest of the UK, but would give meaningful more flexibility for the Scottish Government to respond to other forms of shocks.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Okay, Michael, to follow by Liz.
Thanks, Convener. So, in the absence of any real public discussion before the agreement, publication of the report, parliamentary scrutiny beyond that, so we're left reading priorities into the text, I suppose. And it seems that the Scottish Government has put the population dynamics as a higher priority than perhaps other economic challenges, for instance, you know, low GVA or longer-term lack of investment in R&D that might be driven by more capital spend. Is that your feeling, that they've put that kind of the immediacy of those issues ahead of perhaps longer-term economic transformation, as they might put it?
I'm not sure I would quite go that far. My understanding is that on the block grant adjustment, you're right that by focusing on population with regards to the block grant adjustment, that has sort of tried to address something that would hit the Scottish budget immediately. As I said, around £50 million a year accumulating for each year that wasn't accounted for. I think on the capital side of things, it's perhaps less the case that the Scottish Government didn't want to prioritise that than the UK Government really didn't want to see too much ground in that area. I think this is a personal opinion, not opinion of no inside knowledge or anything. I think the UK government is perhaps concerned that if it was to grant substantial additional borrowing powers for capital investment, that those could be used in the short term to substantially boost spending and could be used in arguments about the constitution. So I think that the UK government would have been much, much more reluctant to see substantial additional capital borrowing powers, particularly in the context of the sort of current setup in the rest of the UK, where there are no England-only capital borrowing powers. So I think you're right that it has ended up prioritising kind of short-term funding issues over long-term potential investment, but I'm not sure that was sort of a thing that was really substantially under the Scottish Government's control to really vary.
Mary?
Yeah, and I suppose the cumulative nature of the population risk and comparing it to the comparable method on the table, if those were the two methods that were on the table, made it, you know, from the Scottish Government's perspective, a no-brainer to you know, I suppose it doesn't mean they can also try and push for increased capital borrowing powers. And as I said, they have extensively used those capital borrowing powers since they've been in place, up to sort of 75% of their overall cap in the current year. So I guess the Scottish Government would say, perhaps in the negotiation, obviously they were trying to argue for both, but they, from their perspective, they absolutely had to secure, I think, the IPC method, because, you know, that cumulative erosion of the spending power of the overall budget would be, you know, a significant issue, you know, permanently embedded in their fiscal framework.
I mean, the terms of this negotiation, as much as, you know, other members may describe it as the UK government having the whip hand in this, is a two-party signatory agreement where one party can withhold agreement and say, you know, until we get more of what we want, we're not going to agree to it. As much as you describe, you know, that the one party, I think for very sound reasons, as you're explaining, David, may be reluctant to go in some direction. You know, it's a two-party agreement. So I suppose that kind of takes me to that issue about how rushed some of this feels towards the end, you know, a long-term process. We're locked now into, described in here as an agreement for over 50 years, on the basis that it feels like trying to deal with a short-term issue, perhaps in terms of those borrowing capabilities, to deal with a £1 billion black hole of the Scottish Government's own making. So, I mean, is that not part of the risk in the way they've dealt with this, about actually setting those really short-term budget priorities? How do I get through this budget year? And they've locked us into a process for 50 years as a result.
Well, The fiscal framework provisions do make clear that both governments can suggest changes to the fiscal framework review that would be reviewed by the Joint Exchequer Committee. I imagine that this committee or future iterations of it in the Scottish Parliament would be interested into how their scrutiny can come to bear on any discussions or make suggestions or whatever in terms of how it can be. And I don't think that this agreement is going to lay untouched for 50 years. I think that's very unlikely. So there are provisions to suggest to make changes. There just isn't, like there was in 2016, a point at which it would definitely be reviewed. And really, the trigger for that was because the two governments in 2016 couldn't come to a permanent agreement on the BGA mechanism, really. And now that they have, it doesn't mean that other provisions in the framework couldn't be looked at. Obviously, the £1 billion issue that you refer to was set out in the medium-term financial strategy, and that was the revenues that the government thought they would have access to spend compared to the commitments they had made. So, I mean, that's obviously up to them to explain how they're going, which things they're not going to do in order to meet that challenge, and that's what they'll be doing in their budget. And I suppose particularly the increased borrowing powers did make this issue a little bit easier, given that they are able to borrow for the whole of the income tax reconciliation now, whereas they weren't before. But I don't know if your characterisation is fair, because there are clearly going to be opportunities to review this in future years. The Scottish Government and the Treasury can make suggestions and changes. So, as I say, I don't think this is going to remain as it is for 50 years.
But I mean, before I bring you in, David, the Barnett formula that we've been discussing was set in similar circumstances, where it thought it might be revised within a couple of years, and it's existed for decades and decades, and we're still unpicking the complexities of it. But maybe Mary wants to come back to me on that one, but before you do.
I think it is fair to say that sometimes these arrangements, which are seen as temporary, can end up becoming permanent fixtures of the system. I think it is also fair to say that the Scottish Government would have had a mind on the kind of short-term fiscal position when it comes to kind of trying to reach an agreement for the current financial year. I think I would point out, though, I think there might have been a typo in some of the notes, because my understanding is that it's not a 50-year review cycle, it's a five-year review cycle, because it's 5 years, but not more than once in any UK or Scottish electoral cycle. So I think there might just have been a typo in the notes that said 50 years.
Upon which basis decisions are made, I suppose. Thanks, Gabriel.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I'm sure a future UK government, if it wanted to be more generous to Scotland, could easily reopen those negotiations. Liz.
Thank you. Can I return to the issue of forecasting and OBR and SFC? Because I think what you've set out for us is extremely important in determining not only some of the issues within fiscal frameworks, but about setting budgets. And we've obviously had both the OBR and the SFC in front of this committee. I have to say, extremely professional in both cases. Is there evidence, statistical evidence, within recent trends of the forecasting for both OBR and SFC that there is particular data that is showing a greater issue of error or volatility, or is it just the overall predictions that are providing some problems for us?
My understanding is that there's a particular difficulty around self-assessment, because if you look at the most recent year, the initial expectation was around £700 million reconciliation. It came in just under £400 million, the £300 million difference. Now, as a share of overall income tax revenues, that's only about 2% or so. But as a share of the self-assessment revenues, that is probably more like 15%, 10 to 15%. So there's quite a sort of issue around self-assessment. I think there's also a risk, looking forwards, and I think the Scottish Fiscal Commission has quite a difficult task ahead. Do we baseline this faster growth and assume that it's now a higher level? Or there'll be some reversion to the mean. We grew faster in this year, and then we'll grow slower in the subsequent year. So I think there is a particular issue around there. More generally, we've seen this big issue in the economic statistics in the UK recently, where different earning series are just giving a vastly different picture about what's happening to earnings. So, for example, if you look over the last few years, things like the Labour Force Survey, Average Weekly Earnings, and ASHI, some of the big main surveys we use for earnings, they've grown much slower than what HMRC data suggests. But if you look at the last couple of months, the HMRC data suggests much slower growth than some of these other indices. And I know that the SFC can account for the HMRC data that it gets through as a feed, but we know that data isn't a full sample. So I think there are issues, particularly on self-assessment, and there is just the fundamental issue that earnings data in the UK does seem to have got a lot worse recently, and that is causing some issues in the forecasting process.
When you say it's got a lot worse, is it that the trends of that forecast have got worse? Oh. Or is there just extra volatility in the earnings and it's very difficult to predict that? Is there a problem with the statistics that we're using and therefore there's difficulty for OBR and SFC to interpret that? Or is there something else that is causing a problem?
There's definitely issues with the statistics around labour market statistics currently. There's been a big drop in the response rate to surveys like the Labour Force Survey and the Annual Survey of Hours and Earnings, ASHI, and that's made it much harder to know what's generally going on, both to employment and to earnings, particularly for those parts that are not so well covered by the income tax statistics. Yeah. So what's happening to the self-employed and what's happening to those at the bottom of the labour market.
I think the Financial Times had an interesting article about this just a couple of weeks ago, that the actual data presentation is making life very hard for OBR and for SFC. Do you think, I mean, obviously this matters to us big time, because obviously the data is absolutely crucial in not only informing us what the current economic picture is, but for informing government when it sets policy. Do you think there is anything else that we can do to help the forecast, to reduce the forecasting error, which obviously has created difficulties between OBR and SFC over certainly the last few years?
Oh, can I come in there? I think that it would be difficult to reduce the forecast error very much more. I think there are huge challenges with earnings and all of the data about the labour market right now that have been well documented in terms of ONS's difficulties with response rates and the labour force survey, and whether they're going to be addressed by the sorts of transformations that the ONS are trying to put in place. I'm not sure, to be honest. It's a big challenge. And we've seen this feed through even into what the Bank of England are thinking about the economy and the decisions that they're making, because they're hearing very different signals about wage growth in the economy. And remember, the SFC has extra challenges here because it doesn't have all of the data sources for Scotland that the OBR have at the UK level. So it doesn't have AWE equivalents to be able to look at them and see that they're different to the HMRC data. All they have is the HMRC data, and they're doing their best to try and forecast. So, you know, extra data sources could possibly be made available to allow them to do these sorts of things. But, you know, there are huge challenges in collecting this data at the UK level at the moment, and so it is pretty difficult. You know, I would always advocate for more access to data for analysts and researchers. HMRC data is a particularly difficult area for academic researchers and researchers outside of government like David and I. So, you know, any more access to data will obviously help. But forecast error is always going to be a feature of it. And the SFC's forecast errors, because they are forecasting for a smaller economy, you know, the data and the forecast are likely to be slightly more volatile. So whatever forecast error the OBR has, you're probably going to get a slightly bigger one just because of a smaller economy. And these are part of forecasting. And it's just, you know, it's sort of amplified for Scotland because there's the SFC forecast error, the OBR's forecast error. They could go in the same direction, but they might go in opposite directions. And therefore, the sort of issue is amplified for the Scottish budget.
Which hits the nail on the head, you know, in Scotland, a difficult job because obviously it's two forecasts you're having to deal with rather than just one. And given what you've said, you know, if we do have to accept that there will be a degree of forecast error, we've got to play that into the system. Do you happen to know that when both the OBR and the SFC are looking back at the predictions that they made and how that turned out in practice, is there a lot of cooperation between the two just to assess where some of that forecast error came in? Is it, in your opinion, is that sort of well documented?
They work together very closely, is my understanding, and will be trying, as fellow analysts and forecasters, doing a very difficult job to, wherever possible, learn from each other and to improve the situation. And let's not forget, the last, 5 years or so when the SFT has been set up has been a mad time economically, and lots of things have happened that weren't expected, There have been a lot of difficulties that none of us could have predicted. But yes, my understanding is they're working very closely together as fellow analysts to try and, wherever possible, share information and to understand where their models are maybe looking at things slightly differently to try and reduce differences.
And the OBR has recently been doing some work looking at its Scottish forecasts. Now, it actually focused more on its own forecasts of Scottish revenues as opposed to its forecasts of our UK revenues, which go into the block on adjustment, which actually is what matters for the Scottish budget. But that sort of work, I think, can be really useful. And I think, both of them do forecast evaluation reports as well, which look at kind of the historic performance of, their forecasts and try to learn lessons from those. And I'm pretty sure they also look across their two systems. I was just going to add as well that these issues around sort of forecast errors, the fact that there will always be forecast errors, I think means that it is worth thinking about, as I said, not just the increase in limit we've already seen, which will help address bigger forecast errors than previously, but is there a case to go even further and potentially say, look, combined to cover any forecast error, but subject to some overall cap and some sort of time limits on repayment? I think I'd also go back to the fact that actually understanding qualitatively, at least, which direction any adjustment may come from, I think actually is important. And then it's up to the Scottish Government to set its budgets with those risks in mind. Mm. My own view is a little bit that in 2021-22, when we've had this reconciliation, that it was quite clear at that stage that Scottish revenues weren't going to outpace those in the UK by £500 million or whatever was said. It would have been possible for the Scottish Government to bank some of that money into reserves to reduce potentially the amount that needs to be, taken in borrowing in this year, in the coming year, to help smooth things.
Yeah, that's very helpful, and I think the committee would agree with that statement that it's an inexact science. Obviously, we have to accept that, but it's just trying. Is there anything we can do within terms of budget analysis and fiscal framework analysis to ensure that the forecasting error is as minimal as we can possibly make it?
If I could just add, we've talked before about the issue of the RUK forecast, which the block grant adjustment is based upon, coming from the OBR, the differencing off of the OBR Scottish forecast from their UK forecast, but their Scottish forecast is done using a different economic model and not Scottish-specific economic determinants. Now, the OBR, in their commentary around their Scottish forecast, do seek to adjust the Scottish share based on Scottish-specific factors, and some of the work they're doing, to look at that may well improve it. And I think that's a potential area for that. More work could be done on that area, because the RUK forecast, as I say, is differencing off that from the UK forecast, and their view on the Scottish economy not being based on a Scottish-specific model is potentially a bit of an issue. And obviously there are other approaches that are going on in other parts of the UK on this sort of issue. Wales has made a different decision about the extent to which it's got its own fiscal institution. It's asking the OBR to do this at the moment, at least. So it'll be interesting to see how these sort of different approaches to this are leading to different outcomes in terms of things like reconciliations and forecast errors and so on.
Thank you, it's very helpful.
Thank you, Michelle.
Good morning. I just wanted to go back to a comment you'd made earlier, David, in terms of CAPEX and what you thought the accommodation that had been made by the UK government. I mean, in some respects, I'm surprised. I can appreciate why the Scottish government wanted to fix on the IPC for all the reasons that we've discussed. But in terms of the kind of current fiscal challenges, I'm also surprised that they didn't push more around the kind of CAPEX thresholds, given what it could bring. Well, there's a very real need for capital projects, but also what it could have brought to the economy in the complete absence of really any of the meaningful levers to grow your economy they might ordinarily respect, because a lot of what we're discussing is dancing on the head of a pin, really, in terms of this nature of this fiscal transfer, the way things are happening in the UK. So, I mean, do you agree with my assessment? Like, if you had been doing that, would you also have been pushing hard on increased capital borrowing powers with the very intent of using them, because there's a good reason to do so in the current economic climate?
So, first of all, I must say, I don't know what was going on behind the scenes. Mm. We wrote the independent report and had some discussions with the two governments in the context of that. But I do not know sort of what conversations and how much different aspects are being pushed by both governments. So I couldn't say whether they should have pushed it more or whether they pushed it as hard as they could and it was a red line for the UK government. I don't know. As I said, my sense is the UK government would be more concerned about giving ground on borrowing than it would be on what accumulate quite large amounts on the BGA side, but in any one individual year, relatively small amounts. So I wouldn't want to comment on should they have tried harder, because I don't know how hard they tried there. What I would say on the capital borrowing limits is that, on the one hand, I think you could argue that, well, yes, given that we know inflation for many things on capital is actually outpacing the sort of GDP deflator at the moment, which is a kind of comment raised earlier, actually, if you want to maintain the real value of the capital borrowing, actually linking it to capital inflation as opposed to GDP inflation might have been a start. When it comes to what is actually, you know, the priority then in terms of further increases to increase capital investment or increase resource investment, I think there's a kind of question there about what is the Scottish Government's, you know, real challenge? Is the real challenge at the moment actually maintaining services and maintaining the resource side of the budget, or is it maintaining sort of the investment in the economy? And also, what is the, I guess, supply side capacity for these things? Is it the supply side capacity to deliver substantially higher investment without driving up costs further? I don't know the answer to those, but I would hope that the Scottish Government was doing some work thinking about those things when thinking about its negotiation strategy, not just thinking about what are the numbers, but where can it have the biggest bang for the buck and where can it avoid, for example, having spillover effects that end up, say, pushing up costs and undoing some of the potential benefits that the higher limits could give you.
That's very helpful. Do you want to come in on that point, Mary?
I just absolutely agree. A lot of the challenges from government capital spending can actually be about the capacity for delivery. Obviously, there's been lots of challenges through COVID and everything else about, you know, the supply of materials and also labour. But government does have to consider these things. To what extent is their capacity to deliver on this capital spending programme that they're looking to set out? And there has been significant challenges in some parts of Scotland in doing that in recent years. So it's definitely something to consider, because, as David says, otherwise you might just push up prices further.
And I'm not sure it's the same in Scotland, but certainly in England, capital budgets are consistently underspent because delivery lags planning.
No, that's very helpful clarification. Thank you. And just on that point, in terms of the kind of like the baking in of some of these things we've been discussing today and the nature of fiscal transfers, how then does that now compare with other fiscal transfer systems that we see elsewhere in the world? I mean, we've previously talked about how complex it is. I suppose my question is, are we simply baking in the complexities that will need to be managed going forward? We've talked about some of that earlier. Or does it start to move to more comparable methods elsewhere? I don't think so, but you're the experts.
So on that one, I'd say that, you know, because the UK started with a highly centralised position and it's been devolving things rather than starting with a sort of like decentralised system and centralising certain things, this idea of like there being block grant adjustments linked to particular taxes is quite unusual, but I think that reflects a starting point. We're moving from a point where everything's centralised to decentralised and trying to kind of avoid where possible detriment, avoid where possible taxpayer unfairness. So I think it's understandable how we ended up in that situation. That is quite unusual and it is quite complex. We actually think things are less complex than in many countries is around what happens after the point of devolution. Many countries don't just have sort of a fixed block grant adjustment that goes up in line with what happens in the rest of the country or doesn't respond to changes in the relative circumstances of the countries. There's some sort of insurance or equalisation mechanism on an ongoing basis. So, for example, in Germany or in Scandinavia, if your economy grows faster than the rest of the country, you get to keep some of that, but you hand some of it back to the central government so it can be redistributed. Similarly, if you fall behind, you get some insurance to sort of stop you falling further behind. And when the Northern Ireland Fiscal Commission looked at this for Northern Ireland, it said that whilst we agree that, you know, at least in the first instance, the principles sort of underline the Scottish Agreement, that it should be economic responsibility. Scotland should gain or lose if its revenues grow faster or slower from devolved revenues so that it has responsibility for its policies. There should be some backstop to that so that if, because we know that revenue performance is partly driven by Scottish decisions, but partly things outside of the Scottish Government's control, there should be some backstop if the revenues fall too low or some actually, if you like, I'm not sure the backstop's the right idea, but some sort of mechanism to redistribute to the rest of the UK if they grow particularly fast. That is something we don't have in this fiscal framework in Scotland. Many countries do. So I think that in future arrangements and future reviews, it would be worth looking at, is some form of ongoing insurance or caps or ceilings, does that make sense in the context of the Scottish fiscal framework?
Yeah, absolutely. And the Northern Ireland report really goes into this in a lot of detail. And it's a really interesting discussion about the extent to which, obviously, the devolution of taxes adds to accountability and all of these things. But that this is something to consider that isn't present in the UK system, which is quite unusual. But, you know, it's built on the fact... You can totally see how we've got here, because, as David says, you know, we have the centralised system and you know, Barnett had to remain, you know, was also one of the agreements. So therefore, the complex position we've ended up in is the best way to meet some of those principles that are set out in the Smith Commission, albeit that they're intention. So it's completely understandable to how we've got here. And there'd have to be some quite significant reforms for it to be more like a more federal system or a different approach.
Okay. And just one last question, picking up on what John Mason was talking about earlier. To what extent are we baking in the recognition of the kind of just tremendous pool, I think Vince Cable said, for the vortex, it's London, southeast, it sucks everything in. Are we not simply recognising that that will continue to be the case and always be the case, even allowing for a technical mechanism where if there was some cataclysmic event with very little capacity, regardless of whether it's Scotland or anywhere else, to do anything about it within what has now been devised?
So, as I said, I think kind of the fundamental tension on this sort of like should London and the South East be sort of excluded from the comparison comes back to this: how do you prioritise no detriment versus taxpayer fairness? How do you kind of like square the revenue side and the spending side of the budget? Now, one way you can do that whilst keeping with a sort of relatively simple mechanism which compares to the whole of the UK is to have this sort of backstop, which says that if this trend were to kind of be an ongoing thing and Scotland were to fall behind, that there is either some sort of reset mechanism or some sort of insurance mechanism which sort of prevents that continuing indefinitely. Equally, if Scotland were to actually do the other way around, the kind of flip side is if Scotland were to improve relative to the rest of the UK, there would need to be some sort of reciprocal arrangement. But those mechanisms might be a way to address those sorts of concerns that John Mason raised, whilst sort of having the sort of main underlying system still be not overly complex and still based on revenues in the whole of the UK.
Whilst recognising that spending in Scotland is being supported also by the revenues that are being generated in London and the South East, yeah, you know, through Barnett, you know, that it's always important to remember that as well.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And just we've covered all the summary of changes to the fiscal framework except one. It's just to give us a fairly minor one, but I think it would be remiss not to touch on that. It's just to, I wonder if you can tell us, David, about what's going to happen with the Coastal Communities Fund and what that will mean for Scotland. I mean, we understand from the agreement that it will be absorbed into Barnet with no immediate impact on funding, but what would be the long-term implications?
I must own up to not having looked into this in any great detail. I can explain it in sort of principle. So by rolling it into Barnet, what it means is that subsequently that will then be in the sort of comparability factors that are allocated to a department in England, so that subsequently any increases for that department, Scotland will get a population share of the increase that relates to that part, which is the communities sort of a Coastal Communities Fund in the rest of the UK, also in England, I should say. So if Scotland would otherwise receive a bigger than population share increase in subsequent funding, then Scotland will lose out from this mechanism. If it would receive a smaller, it will gain from this mechanism. It depends on its relative use of these.
What are the financial parameters we're talking about?
I must say I've not looked at this issue, sorry.
I'm not sure it could be there either, sorry.
Well, on that positive note, we'll end the session. I want to thank both our witnesses very much for contributions. I know both are going to be involved in the next session, but we'll just call a wee break to 11:05 in order to bring in our new witnesses. Thank you. We now move to the next item on our agenda, a roundtable discussion on value-added tax assignment in Scotland. For this session, I welcome to the meeting Charlotte Barber, Deputy President, Chartered Institute of Taxation; David Phillips, Associate Director, Institute for Fiscal Studies; John Ireland, Chief Executive, Scottish Fiscal Commission; Professor Mary Spouge, Director, Fraser Allen Institute; and Mark Taylor, Audit Director, Audit Scotland. We have around 75 minutes for this session. I'd like it to be a discussion between us all. So if witnesses or members would like to be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks and I can then call you. So initially, I'm going to ask a question to yourself, Charlotte, and then anyone who wishes to comment on that, just let me know and we'll follow the discussion as we move forward. So it will be somewhat different from the last session. Okay, so in your submission, Charlotte, on behalf of the Chartered Institute of Taxation, you've said, and I quote, "The lack of a suitable model for identifying and assigning VAT revenues raised in Scotland, the lack of policy autonomy that would be afforded to the Scottish Government from a policy of assignment and the introduction of additional risk to the Scottish budget," meaning your view that this would be a very highly risky adventure, so to speak. So I wonder if you can expand on that.
Thank you very much, Convener, for inviting me to speak and for our submission. That kind of summarises our submission, I think, as to where we are, that we spoke at a round table previously on VAT assignment and had reservations about it at that stage. For those three main reasons, there's been some interesting work in the intervening period. I think, however, the reservations remain. The model, I mean, broadly speaking, VAT assignment means taking all the VAT in the UK and then trying to work out an allocation, a divvying out of the kitty to give some to Scotland that's meant to represent Scottish VAT. And I'm not convinced that we've got an assignment model that makes it clear any actions that the Scottish Government has taken that then influences directly that VAT that comes back. It's very difficult to see the connections between the two. I mean, obviously, in very broad principles, if the economy grows, you'd hope to have more VAT, but I don't think you've got close connections. I think, too, that because you're assigning part of UK VAT in its broadest sense, then you're not going to have a lot of influence on policy over VAT, and that, too, is questionable if you're trying to tie tax and policies together. And last but not least, as we've been discussing in the earlier suggestion, any kind of modelling will bring in risks. And so you've got further risks attaching to this. And I think from last time when we looked at the models, the more you try and pin down where the risks sit and identify them and tighten them, then the more complicated you make it. And the more complicated you make it, the less transparency and visibility you have. So not dissimilar to some of the kind of forecasting discussions that we've had earlier on today.
Okay, thank you. And John Ireland for the Scottish Fiscal Commission, you've said, and I quote, "We are still in a situation where the estimates of VAT raised in Scotland are too volatile to be suitable for the purposes of VAT assignment."
Yes. I think as far as the Fiscal Commission is concerned, we're sort of really want to hold back on sort of the political debate about VAT assignment. But I think for us, the practical issue is how would we forecast what's assigned? And for us, I think that's difficult, and it's difficult for a couple of reasons. I think, first of all, we still don't have clarity, absolute clarity, on what the VAT assignment model was. The best information we have is the 2018 paper from the Treasury and HMRC on the model, but that still leaves lots of important details unclear. So there's a lack of transparency in terms of what the assignment model is. We have had, since we last had a roundtable, we've had a lot more assignment data being published by HMRC. That's helpful. That allows us to get a better sense of where our forecasts work or not. However, there are problems there that data is back revised. So as you can see from our submission, the charts and the figures in there seems to be about the last publication had a third of a billion for each year for most of the back series. And then for the last observation, it had a billion revision. And that sort of volatility makes it hard again to forecast. It also makes it hard to operate the reconciliation process as well. So there's an issue there. And then I think the final issue for us is that we're still because we're forecasting the output of a model, and that by definition that model includes a lot of sort of random error, we have to forecast not only the sort of the real economic VAT, the notional VAT, but we also have to if our forecasts are going to be accurate, forecast that forecast error, and that's very difficult too. So there are a number for us, I think, a very severe number of practical issues around the VAT assignment model that concern us.
Okay, before I get trampled and people wanting to come in, because no one has so far, just to add to what you've actually been saying there, I mean, the HMRC did a presentation this morning, and they said that the changes between each publications in the last year were indeed the highest they've been in the last decade at 9.81%. Mark, what you've said is that implementation of VAT assignment would further increase uncertainty, volatility and complexity of the Scottish Government.
Absolutely. I mean, we're used to those things now in the fiscal framework, so I think it's per se the fact that those things exist is not problematic. I think our entry point for this is, for this to work, there needs to be that public confidence in the robustness of how it works, and it needs to be that public confidence that the benefits that it brings in terms of the aims of the Smith Commission around accountability and the like, and we heard discussion about those aims this morning, are evident in the model. There's more information to understand that, that's needed to understand that. Stripping back from that, I think the other thing to flag, and I'm sure we'll get into more detail around this, is that although in other areas of the fiscal framework there are risks of estimation, there's a small amount, for example, in the Scottish Income Tax outturn. In terms of scale, this is all estimation, and therefore it brings in a new thing in a fundamental way around estimation error, where we will never know how much that error has actually played out in any of the outturns, because the outturns themselves are estimates as well. So there's a new thing to understand and deal with. I think since we last discussed this with Finance and Constitution Committee in a similar roundtable, there is more information, as John Ireland says, available from the HMRC, which helps get more of a sense of the scale of those risks and the scale of that estimation error. But we're still a long way from really understanding how much that plays through. And the last thing I just mentioned at the outset is, in terms of the ability to manage that estimation error, the resource borrowing powers are not available for that. They're available for forecast error and not for the estimation error. So there'll be a lack of clarity about the volatility. How much of that is due just because of how statistically we've measured this, and how much is due to performance of the economy and how that plays through the model? We'll never know that, and there'll not be the ability for government to use any stabilisation mechanisms, borrowing powers, to adjust to that. So it adds an extra layer of risk on top of that volatility, complexity and uncertainty risk that always already exists in the fiscal framework.
Yeah, I'm going to bring in one of my colleagues in a minute, a couple of others who want to speak. I'm going to bring in first. First of all, David, you've said, just to add a wee bit more to the mix here, you've said VAT is properties that make it a relative poor candidate for devolution, although we're talking really about assignment here at the moment. And then you go on to say the administrative difficulties of devolving VAT to Scotland should not be overstated.
So I think what I would say is that the model of assignment that has been suggested so far for use if VAT is assigned to Scotland is a statistical model. So it's not one where you actually work out exactly how much VAT was collected in Scotland. You do not assign a tax base to Scotland. You try to estimate a share of the UK tax base that can be reasonably apportioned to Scotland. That comes with a kind of number of issues we just talked about. I think there are ways in which you could perhaps now reduce the degree of measurement error, particularly on the consumer side. So rather than just relying on the LCFS, I think there is now scope to, for example, use credit card and debit card data and real-time information from banks and so on to improve the modelling of that side of things. But that sort of mechanism would always be a statistical mechanism. And as has been pointed out, you actually never have an outturn. You just have an updated estimate. You have a forecast estimate and then an updated estimate. Now, when I talked about kind of VAT being, a relatively difficult candidate for devolution or assignment, I think the alternative approach would be to say, well, let's actually split up the UK's VAT and try to assign the tax base more directly to Scotland. So to ask companies to split out their sales and transactions, not just with other companies, but intra-company transactions when things move, for example, a warehouse in Northumberland to a warehouse in Fife, or a warehouse in Fife and a shop in Northumberland. If one was to ask companies to do that, that would actually allow you to do a full assignment and not have these forecast errors, but that would be a lot of additional administration and compliance costs for an assignment model. Even for a devolution model, it would be only worth going through that sort of issue if one expected there to be notable, significant changes in tax policy rather than just changes around the edges. So that was the point I was trying to make. We shouldn't say that VAT cannot be devolved to Scotland. If Scotland wanted to make substantial policy changes, it is a tax that can be devolved. We see subnational taxes, although generally sales as opposed to VAT taxes in other countries. Substantial policy change can rationalise that. But if it was to be devolved and made very little changes, or certainly assigned, it wouldn't make sense to kind of go down that route of actually trying to split the tax base up. That leaves you with a statistical methodology, which I think can be improved upon what's in there now, but I still think it will be in a situation where knowing to what extent changes from year to year are actually because of economic fundamentals versus changes in the measurement error, that could be an issue in terms of the financial accountability for the Scottish Government under the assignment model. So I know I've spoken on a lot of issues there, but I hope that makes sense, my sort of points.
Okay. Mary and then John Mason.
Yeah, so I suppose there's two things for me about the sort of sense that this makes overall and then the practical difficulties with actually doing it. And so others have said in their submissions and in their comments so far that the extent to which the VAT that's generated is related to the sort of economic activity that the Scottish Government may have control over in terms of generating or supporting in the Scottish economy is questionable. And also there's lots of issues around the distributional effects of VAT and the sorts of things that's actually levied on and so on. So to what extent it actually makes sense that this is a tax that would be assigned in order to, I suppose, incentivise support or growing the economy and so on, I would question. And, you know, it does just open up a large proportion of the budget to significantly expanded risk. But the biggest problems are really about the practicalities of assignment and the fact that after almost a decade of work, there isn't a model which is sufficiently accurate or can estimate these things to a precision which is suitable for this purpose. And there are, as David has pointed out, potential improvements to consumption data that the ONS are looking into for all of these issues around estimating consumption in the national accounts. Those sorts of investigations into these data have been going on for some time, and there are lots of issues about using scanner data, credit card data and so on, because it doesn't identify individual products and things like that. So, you know, these are not without challenges, but it may be that the estimation of the household proportion of the VAT assignment would improve over time. That is possible because it does seem like there's data that could do that. But the rest of the model is subject to quite a lot of national accounts data, which is open to revision in perpetuity forever. And some of the questions I would have about this is not just the extent to which there'd be volatility in the estimates, but what degree of time are these estimates going to be open for revision and reconciliation? Because the entire series of national accounts is revised quite often, and particularly the areas that are using national accounts type data around things like financial services and so on, that in particular is open to revision and methodological changes and so on. So I just think overall that I don't think there's a way that this could get to a point where it was suitable for this purpose. And so I just don't think it's a good idea.
Yeah, I'm not hearing an overwhelming endorsement from people around this. I was going to say round table. It's more like a horseshoe, to be honest. Everyone's all bunched together, you know. John Mason.
Hey, thanks. I had a couple of questions, and I think David Phillips has maybe partly answered the one I was going to ask him, which was what he meant by the phrase, "I think the noise versus signal ratio would adversely affect the financial incentives, etc." And my other question was to Mark Taylor, really, that you said you thought this would be difficult to audit, and I just wondered what that meant.
Should I start for that one? Thanks, John Mason. I guess the starting point for me around this is absolutely recognise that on the back of what I said around transparency, the importance of that, that from a parliamentary perspective, to have something that says, we've looked at this and we think it's right, is really important and really valuable. And we've had initial discussions with both Scottish Government and National Audit Office about the shape of that and what that might look like. And there's a long way to go before we were able to resolve that question. I think the fundamental challenge is that this is a statistical estimate and those things do not get audited. So what happens in income tax and what happens in devolved taxes is you have actual transactions where the audit process confirms the existence of the transactions and some estimation and some balances around that, but effectively it is actual things that happen that they're recorded and are able to be capable of being audited. In a statistical estimate, it's not an accounting discipline, it's not that same recording of financial transactions where you would end up with an audit opinion in a similar way that we've got an audit opinion both from the National Audit Office on Scottish Income Tax and from teams within Audit Scotland on Revenue Scotland's taxes and the like, Social Security expenditure and the like. That gives a fundamental challenge about what do we mean by audit for this figure. In that initial reflection, I think we recognise that there's work that Audit Scotland to do to kind of explain all this, to set out the process, to give some comments, to give a degree of transparency, a degree of assurance about it's well managed. We could do something around that. We also think we could probably do something, working with colleagues in National Audit Office, ultimately, that says it works the way it was planned to work. The way it's set up is the way in which it's been executed, and possibly even these numbers that come from these places have been input correctly into a process and been reflected properly in a process. So there are different flavours of audit in amongst that. What I think we're clear about and we said in our paper is that the opportunity to have a firm audit opinion on a number that we have in other aspects of the fiscal framework seems very unlikely. We need to get into the detail, we need to have much more discussion, we need to actually have a model that's agreed, so we're talking kind of in hypotheticals at the moment because there's still not an agreement, but that's a kind of sense of where we are in and around that at the moment.
Okay. Yeah, you know, in statistical models such as this and statistical publications, you know, obviously there's the role for the Office of Statistics Regulation here in accrediting statistics that they are, you know, produced, you know, free from political interference and to good standards and all of these sorts of things and provide public value. So, you know, they presumably would have some sort of role in something like this in order to ensure it was accredited as a national statistics publication. And these sorts of methods have been used, not quite over-engineered to the extent that the current VAT assignment model is, but, you know, to estimate statistics that are credited, like GERS, Government Expenditure and Revenue Scotland, and like the country and regional public sector finances that the ONS produce. They are good estimates, probably, of the VATs that's raised in all of the 12 regions of the UK, regions and nations. They're good enough for statistical publication, but they are not precise enough for budgetary purposes. They're not precise enough for VAT assignment. It's not that the estimates aren't probably quite good estimates, it's just they're too imprecise for the purposes of budget setting, in my view.
And Charlotte, you said VAT would be the only assigned tax in the package of taxes to fund Scotland. The UK government would retain full legislative and administrative responsibility. And the aim of VAT assignment would be to bring greater accountability to decision-making in Scotland, but the Scottish Government have no direct controls over VAT rates and policy. So it's kind of going back to what you're saying
initially. What I mentioned at the outset, yeah. And maybe if I could make 2 points, please. In answer to that, going back to what I said at the outset, if you're just getting part of the kitty divvied out, then obviously you've little direct influence over that wider kitty. You're not going to be able to change the rates. You're not going to be able to decide something should or shouldn't be taxable. And on it goes. So I don't think, or you know, what rates you would charge, and I don't think that's necessarily an attractive way to make a government accountable for its economic policies. And I'm not sure, we often talk about how much taxpayers do or don't understand tax. I don't think it draws those connections any closer. maybe leave it at that. The other point I wanted to maybe mention, following on from what David said, we've been talking about an assignment model, and I wouldn't like to leave it on the table, but you can devolve the tax the way you do with income tax, say on rates, or you could fully devolve it, as you can with others that they're still in the making. However, I would have grave reservations about suggesting that we go down that route for two reasons. One is that I think VAT is designed to go across a bigger single market rather than be chopped up into bits of market with everybody accounting for different rates or different things in those bits. And we're quite a highly integrated economy. And I know, John Mason, we've discussed in the past what you would do about products which are, you know, various stages in their production and you're in and out. I'm not sure our major retailers are going to want to account for different rates of VAT in different parts of the UK. That would be quite a hurdle to go over, I think. Unless, of course, as you say, David, you really radically changed what you were doing with your VAT, but then you open up the doors for competition between different regimes, and competition is one side of the equation. The other side of that one is avoidance.
Michael.
Thanks, Camilla. I mean, the practical issues I think Charlotte sets out feel to me to be absolutely huge. I suppose at the time of the Smith Commission, I was very far from privy to any of those discussions. I think we just have to assume perhaps some of the motivations around this, that is it the case that income tax is not a sufficient indicator of economic performance, and therefore the desire was to have a kind of a basket of different taxes that would be indicative of how Scotland was performing. I suppose I'd be keen to hear on people's views as to whether just having the one indicator around income tax performance perhaps creates a very limited set of incentives for the Scottish Government and institutions to drive activity in one particular way within our economy, and that perhaps skews some of the incentives in the way that government might act.
David, yes, I was going to turn to you anyway. But
Sorry. That's why I might come in there. Yes, so I think you're right that having a sort of a broader basket of taxes can give you a broader basket of incentives. In particular, especially as the personal allowance has sort of risen substantially since 2010, or it's now frozen again. But with the personal allowance sort of, you know, taking perhaps around 40% to 45% of adults out of income tax, particularly those with low incomes, and even those above the threshold pay relatively small amounts until they've got substantial incomes. Income tax means you're exposed more to higher income people. VAT would mean that more of your tax revenue performance depends on what happens to lower income people as well. And you might think that's a good thing if you think you want the government to kind of consider income inequality as well as to consider sort of growth in the top of the income distribution. So I think, you know, there can be a rationale for tax assignment. Other countries do use tax assignment to give those incentives, even if there isn't the power to vary the rate. So I'm perhaps not quite as down on tax assignment as a methodology as some people. But I think the practical issues in the current context are difficult to address. In terms of the incentives that are provided by VAT, it would depend very much on how VAT was devolved, if you were to devolve it. If you think about devolving it rather than just assigning it, if you were to devolve it on the same way it's devolved across international borders, with an international border, when something's exported, it's subject to zero VAT, and the VAT becomes fully charged when it's imported. If you did that for Scotland as well, treat the Scottish-English border as an international border for VAT purposes, that would mean that there's an incentive to grow consumption in Scotland, because it would be about the amount that's consumed in Scotland depends, is what drives your tax base. If you were to do it rather than you treat it like an international border, but that the amount that people can reclaim in VAT depends on who they're buying from. So if someone is English buying from Scotland, an English business buying from Scotland, they can reclaim the Scottish rate of VAT. If someone's a Scottish business in buying from England, they reclaim the English rate of VAT. The incentives there could be quite different. Rather than an incentive to boost consumption in Scotland, it's an incentive to grow value added in Scotland. So you can design VAT in ways that within the UK either provide an incentive to boost consumption or to boost effectively production value added. There's different ways you can do it. But as I said, I think the administration and compliance costs in doing that, getting companies, not just on their transactions, but their intercompany transactions to do those things, you only really want to do that if it's going to be a substantially changed policy. But I do think you're right that one of the ideas here was to give it a broader basket of incentives. Although I also think part of it was reference to like what share of taxes are going to be devolved to Scotland. So I think some of it was just let's get to a certain share of the budget devolved to Scotland rather than any sort of full appraisal.
But David, was it not the case that devolution wasn't considered because when we were part of
in
the European Union it wasn't actually permitted
exactly.
to devolve to sub-state legislatures, so assignment was the only way in which VAT could even really be considered?
Yeah, but of course now that is one of the potential things that could change post-Brexit, but as I said, the compliance and admin costs are potentially quite large.
I mean, one of the things that you've actually suggested in your paper, David, is potentially, you know, sales tax rather than VAT. I wonder if you can talk to us about that for a minute.
So the complexity with devolving VAT is because how it is sort of not just charged at the final point of sale, it's charged on each transaction. And so what happens is that a company selling to a company, company A sends to company B, A charges VAT, B reclaims the VAT, B charges it, C reclaims it. And it's only at the final stage then where the consumer can't reclaim it. So it's what's called a fractional collection system. That means it's quite complicated to devolve because lots of goods are transacted across borders, not just across companies, but within companies, and you would need to do that. With a sales tax, that's not the case. With a sales tax, it's just charged on final sales to consumers, and hence you only need to sort of think, where is this being sold to a consumer? That's how sales taxes work in the United States, where you actually see very, very local level sales taxes. You know, individual cities with 5,000 people might have a sales tax that differs from their neighbor. Now, two challenges with a sales tax. The main one is you need to distinguish between consumers who pay the sales tax and businesses who don't pay the sales tax. So whilst it kind of solves the issues around all these intra-company transactions and the kind of production chain, it opens up a new issue around potential avoidance and evasion around, you know, people claiming that they're a business to avoid having to pay the VAT, well, pay the sales tax when they go to the store. The other issue is that all of the tax, rather than being collected as a fraction across the sales, across the production process, it all comes at the final point of sale. And hence, if there is any evasion, you lose all the revenue rather than just the one transaction in that chain. So I think if you wanted to devolve a tax to Scotland, or actually within Scotland to different local authorities, that's been discussed actually within England and Wales, local sales taxes. A sales tax as opposed to a VAT is an easier way to do it, but it brings challenges around evasion, even if it makes the general administration and compliance burden lower.
Yeah, I mean, there's also the issue about cross-border purchases, etc. But we do have sales taxes in the United States, Europe. They're quite common, aren't they, around the
world? In the United States, yes. In Europe, they are sort of sometimes like particular taxes for particular services. For example, tourism taxes. You can think of a tax on sales of tourism services. But it's really the United States and some sort of countries like traditionally India, Brazil. Some of the large federal countries have sales taxes that vary right down to sometimes local levels.
So we've got four political parties represented around this table, and we've got five experts on this issue. Who all thinks that assignment of VAT is a really great idea at this time? Does anyone want to join heroically? I thought you were about to come in there, not? Just remember, this is like an auction. Anyone actually twitches, you'll be called to speak. David, you had your finger on the button at one point there, but you desisted. Because we seem to have come to the situation where we're all more or less in agreement that this presents considerable difficulties right across the board, whether it's from a forecasting point of view, it's from a practical point of view, you know, whether it's from an audit perspective. Does anyone see any real benefits to this that we could perhaps we could eventually reach a benefit? Is there any kind of perfect way in which we could get to that? Is it always going to be a bureaucratic and costly distraction, which isn't going to add any benefit to Scotland. Does anyone want to contribute for or against?
Our committees previously have come to exactly the same conclusion as we have, as in there are strong reasons why this is so complex and difficult. The practicalities are just too great to...
Well, the 11 to 16 committee, which I was as convener, actually did look at it briefly, and we took the view that there hadn't been enough. I mean, we were just... Setting up the Scottish Fiscal Commission was an embryonic stage. We weren't at the stage we're at now, and it was hoped that perhaps in future years we'd be able to look at this in greater depth. Our predecessor committee in the last term of Parliament were very sceptical about this actually being a practical way forward. But it's because it remains part of the kind of Smith Commission. I think it's been one of those... I mean, I take the view, you know, that the Smith Commission's... isn't necessarily in tablets of stone. You know, it's some years ago now, and I think we have to evolve beyond it in some areas, and this might be an area where we have to say in the foreseeable future this isn't going to be a runner. If we've got Scottish government officials actually looking at this, but yet we can see no practical or pragmatic way forward, one wonders whether that's a good use of public resources. Michael.
I mean, I do believe that the principles which we've talked about in committee this morning about economic responsibility for the institutions, the devolved institutions in Scotland, to focus more on how do we grow the economy, how do we get money in people's pockets to generate the taxes to actually provide the public services that we need, is the right thing. But I think it's fair, Convener, that we've had... The institutions have had a good shot at this over some years to try and develop robust mechanisms to project and to deliver some kind of mechanism that this might be achieved. And it doesn't feel to me that that work is bearing particular fruit. I mean, the evidence that we took from in private session from HMRC around this, I think I was less than convinced by in terms of their ability to produce reliable forecasts around this on kind of survey data alone and with some other indicators. I think, but there's obviously a stream of activity that they are funding and supporting is a view to that this is continued government policy. I think we could reasonably ask whether it's money that's being well spent at the moment. But my general broader opinion on that is I think that David Phillips' points, I think, around the fact that we need to make sure we have a focus on a broad economy that takes a different form of rather than a kind of a very narrow view of one part of the tax base, that we need to understand where the role of people who are not earning high levels of income, whether that be wealth, whether that be people who are living in relative poverty, whether that be people who are, you know, whether it be pensioners or our students or people at the bottom end of the income scale. We do need to think about how the government's incentives are structured properly to do that, but it doesn't feel to me that this is a practical means to do that at the moment.
Yes, I mean. Well, so, for example, the HMRC said, John Ireland, I don't know how you would feel about this, but their survey basically said that it would be 2.3% plus or minus a 95% confidence interval. So, that would be their kind of they would be looking for just a ballpark in terms of their predictions. But as we've seen, the revisions that I mentioned earlier on 9.81% out in the current year, which is the highest over a decade. So it almost seems as if volatility has increased rather than decreased as we've progressed with looking at this. How would you feel about that? I know in 2020 was an outlier. I appreciate that. But
I think it's hard to it's hard to unpack the sort of the pandemic and what happened to the pandemic with the sort of the more embedded uncertainty. I think it worries me that there's still a lot of uncertainty in the HMRC things. And I think the other thing that worries me, to be frank, is the lack of transparency. I think we've made no real progress at all in understanding what's in that assignment model.
Well, that's an issue, obviously, Mark's specifically concerned about as well.
Don't understand why HMRC are being so secretive. But I'm sure they have their reasons.
Yes, I'll let you understand, David.
I was going to say that I think the... One issue that one needs to kind of remember here with the sort of confidence intervals is that this is not just a kind of case where you've got a sort of a sample of data and you're trying to estimate a sort of underlying population from a sample. It's not just a sampling issue here. There's fundamentally a measurement issue. There's errors around what are we actually trying to measure. Are the proxies we're choosing the actual doing a good job of actually proxying VAT? So I think that actually working out what the kind of errors are around those is actually very difficult compared to just standard sort of, you know, statistical uncertainty.
Well, we did query that because, I specifically asked about Scotland relative to the other 11 nations, regions of the UK, because our geography, demography profile is a lot different. For example, rurality is quite different from, you know, parts of, you know, Midlands, for example, is less variable. But I think I'm just going to let John Mason in a wee second, but just... we've obviously talked about VAT assignment, and everyone seems to think that for the reasons that we've already been discussed, you know, the fact that it's that the Scottish Government wouldn't even have any control over it whatsoever, it's a bit of a dead duck. What, do people feel the same about the devolution of VAT at this time, or have people got different views on that? But John, we'll start with yourself.
Well, I'm happy to come in on that one, actually, because I was just going to make a comment, really. I mean, when this was first announced, I thought it would be a good thing, partly because, as David kind of explained, there's different models. I assumed that if we attracted a factory to Scotland, that factory would add value. And the whole point of VAT is that it's a tax on added value. So the more factories, and we've been quite successful at that, inward investment, that would allow us to build up VAT from that point of view. But as we also had the briefing this morning, clearly that's not the model that's being looked at. It's purely the end point as to where the consumers spend their money. So, like everyone else, I agree with what Michael Mara said. I'm very sceptical about this going ahead as it is. I'm not quite as sceptical as Charlotte Barber, who kind of said, really it would be horrendous to devolve it. I mean, clearly other small countries, not just sub-nations, but, you know, Norway, Sweden, Netherlands, Denmark, all operate their own systems, I assume, even though they're within a single market. So it should be possible to devolve it. And if we become, as and when we become independent, then we will have our own VAT system. So that is not unmanageable, but I kind of accept at the moment that the costs are probably outweighing the advantages.
Any further comments from anyone? Charlotte?
I think one of the other interesting things in the talk leading up to Brexit was the kind of requests that people across the UK looked for once, you know, the UK had control of VAT and could do what it wanted with it. Everybody was asking for reliefs, and there didn't seem to be anything other than reliefs on lots of different things. And so I guess we would also need to, if we were wanting to think about whether you might or might not devolve and whether it's worth the bother, if, as David says, you need to do something quite different with it, you'd need to think what the difference is. And if it's reliefs, you're going to have less income. Maybe that will generate more businesses coming in here. That would have then have flushed through in the Barnett formula, wouldn't it? Because you'd be depriving it from somewhere else, I guess. There's quite a lot of intricacies in there. And if we're going to do something different by charging more, that too is interesting.
Is the issue, Charlotte, about perhaps it would skew economic activity as well? For example, you know, foods VAT zero rated other areas of the economy, it will be 20%, and it would perhaps skew government policy and decision making if it was devolved into areas where it was likely to have a VAT return?
Well, I think if you were collecting your own VAT, you might be driven in part, mightn't you, by the types of things that attract VAT, and perhaps take your eye off other things that don't, and whether one, I mean, that would all be part of the mix, wouldn't it, as to whether you did want to devolve it and then do something radically different. The other thing I think we've learned over the last 10 years is how inextricably interlinked all the taxes are across the UK. There's the different taxes and there's across the UK, and it's quite difficult actually to do something distinctly different as the way the economy is structured. And I'd say that's one of the learning lessons out of the last 10 years.
David?
Yes, if I can kind of make two separate points. First, on the assignment, I'm not saying we should go ahead with this, but I think it is maybe worth doing a little bit more look. Maybe this has been done already, but it's something I've struggled to do. Looking at how other countries do this, so for example, Belgium, Italy, Portugal, Spain, Germany do have VAT assignments. I try to find information about exactly how it works. How do they estimate the assigned shares? Unfortunately, the information I found was nearly all in the languages of the countries, and it's quite hard to translate. I tried to get ChatGPT to do it for me, but it didn't quite do it correctly. But I think actually it might be kind of, maybe it's already been done, but if it hasn't been done, just looking at exactly how they do it, not the high level information you often can kind of find on the OECD website, but exactly the methodology they use could be worthwhile. Because I think in Germany, it's not just down to the regional level, it's actually down to the local level. It's really quite detailed there. Do they go through the rigmarole of actually making companies split the tax base up in order to do it? Have they thought it's worthwhile in their sort of, you know, more decentralized systems to do that? Or do they use these statistical approaches? And the second point I make is, we sort of to echo what Charlotte was saying, that what you do tend to find actually is that post-Brexit, there was a lot of sort of discussion about further tax reliefs. I think in the context of an independent Scotland, I would imagine that the reference point of what's been happening in the rest of the UK would not be quite such a strong reference point as it is currently. So you might not see kind of the same pressures to just do things a bit different to the UK that you might see currently in an independent Scotland. But yeah, I think kind of being mindful that there would be risks to the tax base associated with political lobbying, I think would be particularly important. That's something we see a lot of with VAT.
Okay, thanks very much. There'll be no fact-finding visits to Italy, Belgium or Germany, I want to make that clear. Mary?
Yeah, my understanding is that is what happened at the start of this process. And, you know, I think it was particularly the Canadian model of assignment that was, you know, or similar taxes assignment that was looked at. The Canadian statistics is much more bottom-up and they have much better data at a local level. But my understanding is that the VAT assignment model is broadly based on what they do in Canada, is my understanding. So the HMRC have looked at, and Scottish Government together have looked at other jurisdictions to try and that this was one of the reasons that they looked at doing it this way. Also because they had the VTTL in existence already to try and estimate the VAT gap for the UK. My concern is really about, you know, it's been 8 years. I don't know how much money has been spent on trying to develop this. I would say not an insignificant amount of money, including the boost to the LCFS, which is good for other reasons, don't get me wrong. But, you know, there has been a lot of money spent. And the improvements in precision have not come. There's been issues about the 2020 data, which are specific to that year. But I think it was you said, Michael, they've given it a good go, but I just think we're at the point where it can't be done to a the precision that's required, and therefore everybody should just agree that it's not a good idea. Because my understanding also was that, you know, it was kind of a bit about, you know, half the Scotland's budget being determined by revenues that, you know, not that they had control over, but, you know, we're in Smith and previous devolution settlements, and it was kind of about getting to that 50% mark, you know, rather than about the taxes themselves being sensible for assignment.
Yeah, I think there's an element of that. I think there was a lot of politics in that. I mean, the Scottish Government felt a duty upon itself to follow the recommendations of Smith and to look at them in detail, and I think it has done that, but how long can you flog a dead horse? I think it's probably the issue here. So I think certainly there's no enthusiasm, certainly for assignment anyway. Devolution, I don't think there's many people who are shouting for the rooftops for that either at this present time, unless I'm mistaken. Nope. Okay, anyone else want to comment on this?
It's a nice cheery session, isn't it?
Right. I think it's actually been a very constructive session, because I think we've had, as has just been said, we've had 8 years talking about this, and if we as a finance committee and with the unanimous support of our witnesses and across the political parties are saying that the assignment should no longer be looked at, I think that's a very strong message that we're actually sending to the Scottish Government on this. So unless anyone's got any further points they want to make, I'm going to actually wind up this quite short round table, I have to say. I expected it to go on a wee bit longer, but I think because of the unanimity of views, which has been expressed through very detailed and high quality submissions, I think that we've come to a very strong and unanimous conclusion. Anyone else get anything else to say? Going once. Okay, well, thank you very much to everyone for attending and indeed participating in today's discussion. It was very useful, and that concludes the public part of our meeting. We'll continue to take evidence on the fiscal framework, and we'll certainly convey our views to the Scottish Government with regard to VAT assignment. We have the Deputy First Minister in next week, and no doubt we'll put these issues directly to her. The next item on our agenda will be discussed in private, and it's a discussion on our work programme. So we now move into private session, and we'll just have a wee 5-minute break to enable our witnesses and the official report to depart. Thank you all.